that I apologize. That was a snafu. We're sitting here ready to go, and we don't have the microphone on. That's my fault. This is a live broadcast from Princeton, New Jersey. My name is Frank Fortunato. Today is Wednesday, March 2nd, 2011. It's 11:30 a.m. Eastern Standard Time in the U.S. It's 4:30 p.m. in London, 12:30 in Bermuda, and in Mexico City, 10:30 a.m. If you need to reach us during the broadcast, you can phone in toll-free at 1-866-67-CATEX. Overseas, our AOL instant mail address is CATEX-TV. Today's birthday, Mikhail Gorbachev, the last leader of the Soviet Union, is 80 years old today. Today's promise, we will not have a Charlie Sheen interview for you. If you live in the United States, you must think that Sheen has taken over the airwaves. He is ubiquitous. He is on all the time. He is giving interviews every day. People are beginning a death watch. It's very clear the man is seriously disturbed. We'll go to our main news. Swiss Re has become the first of the big reinsurers to issue a loss estimate as a result of the February 22nd New Zealand earthquake. Swiss Re estimates that its claims cost, net of retrocession and pre-tax, will be about $800 million. This is based on a total insured claim total of about $6 to $12 billion. This is way high, $6 to $12 billion. Yesterday, QBE came out with their estimates, and their top rung was about $4 billion. Swiss Re observed that take-up rates for insurance and reinsurance were high in New Zealand. Stefan Lipp said that the latest quake in New Zealand took a very heavy toll in terms of human fatalities. Our role, he said, is to enable the people of Christchurch to recover swiftly from this catastrophe. Swiss Re estimate indicates what was already suspected, that much of the Christchurch loss will fall to the reinsurance market. QBE, a primary company in this instance, this week estimated its own maximum loss at $175 million, including reinstatements. Local rivals IAG and Suncor recently said that their reinsurance coverage would protect them from losses much higher than $40 to $45 million. As if that wasn't enough, here's the USGS map from yesterday. A 4.5 aftershock was felt by thousands of people in New Zealand at exactly the same time that they were holding a two-minute memorial service for the 159 confirmed victims. This time the earthquake was about 25 miles underground that was felt 12 miles northwest of Wellington. There were no reports of any damage or injuries, although there were shakes. In Iran, security forces are firing tear gas and rubber bullets now with opposition supporters in downtown parts of the capital. Demonstrators are rallying to demand the release of two opposition leaders. According to opposition websites, security forces and people in civilian clothes clashed with demonstrators downtown to disperse them. Protesters rallied at several points in the capital, chanting death to the dictator. They're talking about President Ahmadinejad. They're calling on authorities to free Mir Hussein Mousavi and Mahdi Karoubi. Both of them were former presidential candidates who ran against Mr. Ahmadinejad. They have not been seen in public since they called for a rally on February 14th, during which thousands of their supporters took to the streets to support uprisings in the Arab world. Iran says it will not respond to any questions about them because this is simply an internal matter. Well, today's update from Libya, talking about taking over the airwaves. Muammar Gaddafi was on for about an hour and a half earlier today in Tripoli. The situation in Libya now is such that Gaddafi's forces are hitting back with some degree of ferocity against the insurgents. The insurgents still control large parts of the country. The Gaddafi forces are expected to make an attack on Benghazi sometime this week. They're moving closer. Benghazi is a resistance stronghold. It's also been determined that despite the fact that the resistance seems to be in control of about 70% of Libya's oil production, payment for those oil deliveries are still being made to Libyan government accounts. So this is going to be a little bit of a discrepancy. If the resistance has access to that money, that presumably might help it. International outcry continues. American warships have now reached points off the coast of Libya. President Obama has yet to declare a no-fly zone, although the situation is becoming increasingly tense. Back to London, Lloyd's insurer Amlin made a profit after tax of about £222 million in 2010. That was down over 50% on the £455 million of profit it made in 2009. Amlin's combined ratio jumped up to 88% from 72%. Return on equity slumped to 13.9% from 37%. Well, there's a reason for that, mainly 204 million pounds of losses from the Chile and New Zealand earthquakes. Amlin was also hit by the storms in Europe, flooding in Australia, and the Deepwater Horizon oil spill. That's pretty good underwriting if they were able to get that much of a net. In Montreal, a second major fire in the city in as many as 2 days has injured at least 11 people, leaving about 50 people homeless. Montreal Fire Chief Luc Robillard said that the fire apparently began in the basement storage area of a three-story apartment building. The fire came a day after a condominium under construction in the Rosemont district of Montreal began burning, with the flames spreading to five other apartment buildings. 75 people were forced to evacuate them. Stock market in New York is up about 23 points right now. We'll go to a word from our sponsors. Automatic Data Processing, ADP, the U.S. payroll giant, has some numbers today. They show that American companies added more workers in February than had been forecast. According to ADP, employment increased by 217,000 last month. This is after a revised gain of 189,000 back in January. The estimate for today, the median, was about for 180,000, so it was up by 37,000 above that. Bigger sustained payroll gains would probably underscore Federal Reserve Chairman Ben Bernanke's testimony to Congress yesterday. Bernanke said there are grounds for optimism about the labor market in coming months. Not a moment too soon. Michael Dyckman, the chairman at Allianz, made an interesting admission the other day. He said that for the first time, he's articulated, given voice to fundamental criticism of the reorganization of Allianz's German operation that he started 6 years ago. This is their primary subdivision. Dyckman said, "With hindsight, I believe the result would have been better for our shareholders if we had been less radical in the cutting of 5,000 jobs in Germany." He said, "Now is the time to reap the benefits of productivity gains rather than cutting thousands of jobs every year." Another board member, Oliver Bott, admitted major restructurings result in many problems, especially in sales and claims handling. That's not good when you're an insurance company. The remarks came after Allianz made major changes to the management structure of its core operation in Germany. They shed 5,000 jobs, They introduced large call centers dealing with customers and agents. They dissolved the regional structure and moved the sales force away from the operative insurers into a separate company. However, the cost ratio of their German operation actually increased, didn't decrease. The combined ratio worsened to 101% in 2010. They're going to have a conference call today in which Allianz Deutschland, the German arm of Europe's largest insurer, is going to publish their detailed 2010 figures. Well, there's been a lot of discussion lately with Toby Esser and now Dominic Burke at JLT. Burke has really weighed in. He says that the big three brokers, Aon, Marsh, and Willis, are going to face another wave of questioning from regulators over the use of contingent commissions. In the aftermath of course, of Elliott Spitzer's investigation into contingent commissions in 2004, the broking market was expected to move toward a situation where fees, as opposed to commissions, were going to be used to remunerate them. Burke says that this is not the case for all brokers. In fact, Burke said that the big three could find themselves being questioned by regulators over their use of contingent commissions. Burke said many brokers, particularly Aon and Marsh, have been winning business by quoting fees of 0%, but then benefit from contingent commissions and profit share agreements, a situation he explained the market had last seen in the pre-Spitzer days. Now, this is interesting because Robert Hiscox said the other day that brokers have to own up and tell their cedents exactly how much they're getting paid and from whom. If they're quoting fees of 0% but benefiting from contingent commissions and profit share agreements paid by the markets, Mr. Hiscox may have a point. Back to Mr. Burke at JLT. He said it's heading back to the pre-Spitzer days. It's not in the interest of clients or the insurance market as a whole, but it's clearly in the interest in the short term for some of our competitors. He said JLT won't go down that model. We don't think it's an appropriate way to do business. The way contingent commissions are moving, they might face regulatory questions again, and that doesn't surprise me. He said every single client we have in every single part of the group can work on either a fee commission or a fee basis or a commission basis. That suits them and they like it. He also said he challenged his rival brokers to enter into a commission-free world to increase market transparency. He said that JLT would be happy to sign up to abolish commissions and work purely on transparent fees if his competitors joined him. Burke also said that reinsurance underwriting discipline right now is very, very, very poor, and that if the current model continues this way, it's not going to be sustainable for the markets because they're intaking business at rates that they can't possibly afford. Wow. Well, we've heard from just about all of the other non-three. Let's see who pops up tomorrow. If we have any breaking news, we'll come back and tell you. In the meantime, thank you for watching, and we will see you tomorrow.